it is an extraordinary joy for me to speak about my good friend Nicholas of Cusa. And given the fact that it is his birthday, somewhere between April and June, he will be 600 years old. And I really mean joy of a friend having birthday, because when a friend has birthday, you realize that without this individual, the world would be so much poorer. And I hope that with my remarks, I will interest you to study Nicholas von Cusa, his ideas and concepts, so that he becomes one of your dear friends too, if he is not already. The reason why this particular man is so extraordinarily important is because it was his ideas which gave the beautiful Italian Florence Golden Renaissance even more higher expressions, because he was the towering genius of all the many geniuses which came together at that point. And it was this unbelievable, fantastic explosion of human creativity expressed in this Renaissance which did overcome the dark age of the 14th century. And it is more urgent today than ever before to study the example of the Golden Renaissance, to find the clues, to find the ways of how we can overcome our present dark age. As during Nicolaus's time, the issue of peace was of the highest actuality, because today we have terrible wars raging in Africa, in the Middle East, in the Balkans, but also within countries like Colombia, Indonesia, and many other countries. The image of man, which Nicolaus so beautifully defined, is again in shambles. And when the British press talks about culling people in the context of the next global flu epidemic, being the equivalent of the hoof and mouth disease for human beings, you can see what is the value of human life today. As in Cusa's time, the challenges of these new diseases are such that a new scientific revolution is required. But also the issues which concerned him, namely what should be the principles for countries and nations and peoples to relate to each other, are of utmost importance today. To answer all of these questions, one of the most important struggles to understand then and now is the fight between those on the one side who contributed to the emergence of the sovereign nation state through fundamental changes in the world outlook in the transition from the 13th to the 14th century, and especially in the 15th century and Nicolaus's contribution, and those on the other side who wanted to go back to imperial structures of the period before that, such as the forces of globalization today. That globalization is a new version of the old Roman Empire, an Anglo-American version, which actually kills entire continents and turns the world into a global plantation, that more and more people can see. But how precious the instrument of the sovereign nation state actually is for the defense of the common good, and what enormous efforts it took to arrive at the concepts of national sovereignty and a community of states based on international law. The knowledge of this has been thoroughly obscured by those who benefit from globalization and who point to the nation state as the source of all evil. What I want to do with this presentation, I want to set the record straight and completely agree with the genius of international law, the late Baron von der Heide, that these ideas of a community of state based on international law are so much integral to European culture that this culture cannot even be thought of without them. Globalization directly threatens the very essence of European culture. Let me therefore present to you some of the ideas which went into the emergence of the nation state and the community of nations based on international law, and then show you why the works of Nicholas of Cusa meant a qualitative change in the tradition of all Platonic thinkers before him, and why his breakthrough of the coincidentia oppositorum, the thinking of the opposites in coincidence, which is today represented in a qualitatively enriched form by Lin, is exactly the necessary level of thinking for a Renaissance today. So what were the necessary steps that the nation state could come into being? Mr. Glazyev spoke 2 days ago about World Organization, IMF, World Bank, WTO, and if you think while I'm speaking about the emergence of the nation state, you can actually see that the efforts to put these instruments of globalization in control of the world is an effort to turn the clock back before the 1100, before actually this idea of sovereignty existed. The Middle Ages were essentially dominated by two poles, the Kaisertum on the one side and the papacy. But they were, despite changing rivalries, united in the concept of a universal Occidental Christianity, in which the philosophical idea of the reductio ad unum, the reduction of the multitude to unity, governed the political thinking of the time. For example, in the Königsspiegel of Gottfried von Viterbo in 1180, develops this universal idea of an emperor with all its tradition in a straight form. Even if there were other regional ruling structures, in the 10th and until the 12th century, one could not call these regional power formations states. It took the decisive change in the political thinking in the transformation from the 13th to the 14th century, in which the different aspects, what eventually with Nicholas of Cusa constituted the sovereign nation state, would emerge. Around the turn of the 13th to the 14th century, the top of the old hierarchical order, the empire and the church as a worldly power, lost influence and power structures on a lower level got strengthened. Eventually, they did not recognize any power above and no decision-making authority above them anymore, taking for themselves the right to decide about the life and death of people. So in the beginning, these regional ruling structures achieved a status, a state, état. The infant Peter von Aragon talks in his Fürstenspiegel of 1355 of the conservative status. The same formulation is used in a letter by Petrarca to Francesco of Carrara about the administration of the community. Also, English authors of the 14th century use the word status for state. The only challenge to the universal hierarchical order of the Kaisertum was in the 10th and 11th century the erection of the Normannic monarchies at the outskirts of the empire, in Western France, England, Sicily, Russia, and Poland, which ignored the philosophy of the power of the empire and based themselves on a strong administration, an own nobility, a mercenary army, a own jurisdiction, and a coherent finance and trade policy. The Normannic historian, Orderich Vitalis, 1142, does not entertain the idea in his book that the Roman Empire of that time continued the Roman Empire of his time, and assumes that the Normans are the carriers of the world historical development for which divine providence would have selected them. This was a peripheral development, but it did not go unnoticed. But the two individuals who can be called the pioneers, not the prophets, but the pioneers of the modern state, were Johann von Salisbury, 1120-80, and Wilhelm of Auvergne, whose both social teaching, however, was still based on a cosmological order. Johann of Salisbury writes the so-called Polygratius, a work of state theory, about the vain worries of the courtiers and the influence of the philosophers. which is one of the few timeless works of state science. But for him, still, the res publica is embedded in the spiritual hierarchy, and the same is true for Wilhelm of Auvergne, Bishop of Paris, who in 1235 wrote the book about the state of the angels being a model for the commonwealths on earth. These two books were the first social theory of all, at all, and crucial for the new theory of state in France, in which the tendency for a developing nation state was most advanced. The Polycratius taught by the Cistercian monk Elion de Froidemont and Wilhelm of Auvergne influenced Gilbert of Tournois, Thomas of Aquin, Bonaventura, and Egidius Colonna of Rome, who wrote the first modern theory of state. Johann von Salisbury emphasized political justice as being an important step in the evolution of political theory. Egidius Colonna was the first to speak of political theory as an independent science, and he was the educator of Philippe Le Beau. So the first sovereign nation states emerged in England with Henry II Plantagenet from 1154 to 89, in France with Louis IX from the Holy One from 1226 to 70, in Sicily with Frederick II of Hohenstaufen 1212 to 1250, in Spain with Ferdinand the Holy and his successor Alphonse the Wise 1252 to 58. And these new state formations all were based on similar features. First, a clearly ordered jurisdiction. Secondly, a territorial structure according to the jurisdiction districts. Third, the superiority of royal courts before those of the nobility and the church. Fourth, the strengthening of royal courts and the emanation of new laws and institutions in a codification given out in the king's name. In England, France, and Sicily, an order of the financial administration developed parallel to the jurisdiction. The result of these reforms in these four states were that the new power structure had power over the life and death being exclusively in the hands of the leadership of the state, and it was taken out of the hands of the lower nobility. There was a consolidation of power internally, and at the same time, the declaration of sovereignty toward the outside. What that meant was first, not to recognize any higher power on earth. Second, the leadership of an emperor in his own territory. Third, to be a coherent community. This notion, not to recognize any higher power on earth, suddenly became the leitmotif in the transformation from the 13th to the 14th century. And this idea became one of the most efficient ideas in the development of modern Europe. In the fight between Boniface VIII and Philip the Bow, this became the fighting slogan of the Royalist Party at the beginning of the 14th century. This led to the States Act on the 23rd of February in 1302, in which Philip the Bow announces to disinherit his sons if they were ever to recognize any higher power in France than God. Alphonse the Wise in Spain, Frederick II in Sicily, declared the same formula. In Sicily, interestingly enough, it was the father and the brothers of Thomas of Aquinas who helped Frederick II to found the Sicilian state. Thomas of Aquinas had developed this idea to a general theory. A counter tendency was the theory of the emperor status of the Pope being a worldly power. Mainly, the main theoretician of this was Egidius Colonna, and his ideas were taken by Pope Boniface VIII, who expressed them in the bulla Una Sancta. There is an anecdote told, which I don't know if it's true, but the anecdote told that he would have climbed up the stairs of a church in Rome and shouted at the people, ergo Caesar, ergo Imperator, which obviously was a complete, not the intention of what popes are supposed to be. On the other side, you had the emerging national sovereignty. The first time this shift occurred, that in the state, not the interest of the king, but the common good was a concern. One step in this direction was the writings of Alphonse the Wise, that the king, as the representative of God, has to guarantee justice and truth for the people they govern. The notion of sovereign equality was first mentioned by the philosopher and poet Lull, Ramon Lullus, at the end of the 13th century. He also had the idea of the persona commune, in whom goodness, greatness, stability for the community are united. For Lull, however, in the 13th century, this persona commune is still the world emperor. Frederick II was the first one to appeal to the reason of the rulers of the sovereign equal states instead of just demanding obedience. A truly revolutionary breakthrough occurred when the Dominican philosopher Johann Kidor of Paris elaborated the idea of a multitude of equal independent states and the idea that there could be only peace in the world if there was no emperor. Only in a system of legally equal states, each limited to their own territory, could there be peace and concordance. The drive for world dominion, the mere idea to be more than the others, brings necessarily non-peace, he wrote. This represented a decisive step in the evolution of modern international law of peoples. Kidor's writings were ammunition in the fight of France against the papal power demands. The then famous lawyer, Peter Dubois, wrote in 1305 in a leaflet, "In my view, there is rarely a reasonable person who would like to believe that concerning worldly matters, there should be one single ruler in the world who would govern everything and to whom all ears would listen. Because if you would drive towards such a condition, there would be wars, riots, and fightings without ends. And nobody could oppress them because there are too many people, too far distances and differentiations of the individual countries, which are too big, and the natural inclination of people for opposition and dissonances is too large." In this entire period, the unresolved tension between the empire and the emerging states were unresolved. The concordantia disconcordantium was the essential conflict of the time. To overcome this tension, the best thinkers and the most advanced kings in the 13th and 14th century tried in vain to find a solution. The poet Dante is an illustration for Lynn's argument that the beautiful visions of the poets are often the inspiration for the politicians. Such was the vision in his De Monarchia, which portrayed the ideal of a world community in which the deep longing for peace was realized. It is interesting that long before this, what von der Heide calls the birth hour of the modern nation state, actually went through its labor pains, Augustinus wrote in The City of God that only the evil state would be imperialistic, a clear reference to the Roman Empire, and that it would be not the concern of well-meaning men to be happy about the size of their empire, because the largeness would have only grown because the injustice of these of against whom justified wars would have been fought, and the empire would be small if there would be calm and peaceful neighbors. According to Augustinus, smaller states would be better than large, never satisfied empires. Extremely important for Alphonse the Wise, for Lull, for Thomas of Aquinas was also the idea of justice in the state. Aquinas even said that life in a society cannot exist if on the top of the state there is not somebody concerned with the bonum communum, the common good. And that is exactly what is the problem with globalization today, that there on the top of these supranational institutions, they could not care less for the common good. What inspired the different philosophers, poets, and state theoreticians who contributed to the idea of international law of peoples and the idea of national sovereignty was a passionate drive for peace and justice and love was regarded as the precondition for peace, especially today, where there is no peace in many areas of the world, where globalization causes wars and threatens with a new global dark age. It is of the utmost importance to understand that it was the desire for peace which stood at the beginning of the development of national sovereignty and international law. The philosopher whose political theory represented a grandiose design for a functioning peace order in the world, who resolved the concordantia disconcordantium, was Nicholas of Cusa, the greatest thinker of the 15th century. His Concordantia Catholica, a paper written for the Council of Basel, not only contains in book one and two ideas about the reform of the church, but in book three, an argumentation for the reform of the Holy Roman Empire. Nicholas gives here for the first time a concrete institutional form to the constitutional demands on the ruler, a major step in the direction of modern constitutionalism and even the separation of powers. Completely new in Nicholas's approach to natural freedom and equality was the idea of natural freedom and equality as the basis for participation in government. Here we have the beginning of the political rights of all people. Nicholas writes in the Concordantia, "Therefore, since all are by nature free, every governance, whether it consists in written law or in living law in the person of a prince, can only come from the agreement and consent of the subjects. For if men are by nature equal in power and equally free, the true property ordered authority of one common ruler who is their equal in power can only be constituted by the election and the consent of the others, and law is also established by consent." This was totally revolutionary, that the rulers and the governed are equal and equally free. And at another place he says, "What is true for the German is also true for the Ethiopian." Nicholas really meant human rights as a universal principle. In book three he writes, "Natural laws precede all human considerations and provides the principle for them all. First, nature intends every kind of animal to preserve its physical existence and its life, to avoid what could be harmful and to secure what is necessary to it. For the first requirement of essence is that it exists." If one would write a new constitution for a world of sovereign nation states, this definition of Nicholas could go into it completely unchanged, because people have to exist first. He continues, "But from the beginning, men have been endowed with reason, which distinguishes them from animals. They know, because of the existence of their reason, that association and sharing are most useful, indeed necessary for their self-preservation and to achieve the purpose of human existence. And therefore, Cusa argues, human beings have built cities and adopted laws to preserve unity and harmony, and they established guardians of all of these laws with the power necessary to provide for the public good." Nicholas then, in the clearest way, establishes that principle which separates the sovereign nation state from the previous oligarchical forms of society in defining the only legitimate source of power in caring for the common good, to which all or a majority of people have to consent with. He says, "All legitimate power arises from elective concordance and free submission. There is in the people a divine seat by virtue of their common equal birth and the equal natural rights of all men, so that the authority which comes from God, as does man himself, is recognized as divine when it arises from the common consent of the subjects. One who is established in authority as representative of the will of all may be called a public or common person, the father of all, ruling without haughtiness or pride in a lawful and legitimately established government. While recognizing himself as a creature, as it were, of all of his subjects as a collectivity, let him act as their father as individuals. That is divinely ordained marital state of spiritual union based on a lasting harmony by which a commonwealth is best guided in the fullness of peace towards the good of eternal bliss. Now, isn't that not beautiful? I really enjoy reading this to see, you know, that a constitution can be based on, you know, the adhesion for the common good, but that, you know, the ruler is also asked to act like a father to all, you know, which obviously requires love. Nicholas then defines the representative system in which the elected representatives enter a reciprocal legal relationship with both the government and the governed. He says, for this purpose, the public welfare, the ruler should have the best qualified of his subjects chosen from all parts of his realm to participate in a daily council with him. These councillors ought to represent all the inhabitants of the realm. These councillors ought constantly to defend the good of the public which they represent, giving advice and serving as the appropriate means through which the king can govern and influence his subjects, and the subjects on proper occasion can influence him in return. The great strength of the kingdom comes from this daily council. The councillors should be appointed to this task by agreement in a general meeting of the kingdom, and they should be publicly bound legally by oath to speak out openly for the public good. Now, you heard yesterday in the panel on the fight for the the DC General Hospital, a living example. If all the citizens would publicly speak out for the common good, like it was done by Charlene or by Dr. Alim, then the state functions. And that is exactly what we have to accomplish. Nicholas wrote this groundbreaking work in 1433, and it took another 343 years until these ideas of a representative system as the only practical way to defend the inalienable rights of the individual were formulated in the American Declaration of Independence and the American Constitution. But for Nicholas, this was only his first major work. His real breakthrough was still to come. That Nicholas was educated by the Brothers of the Common Life is quite probable. However, it cannot securely be established. But a lot is known about his relationship to the height of the Italian Renaissance, which both influenced him as well as he inspired the best thinkers, philosophers, statesmen, and popes with his groundbreaking philosophical method, which was on the one side in the Platonic tradition, but also added a spectacular new dimension to the history of philosophical thought. Nicholas studied from 1417 to 1423 in Padua. So he was there when he was between 18 and 24 years old. Already here, he came in contact with the most precious tradition of European civilization, which had been revived in Italy with Dante, Petrarca, Boccaccio, and who had de facto started a war against the dogmatic scholastic teaching, which dominated much of the academic life in Europe, by consciously reviving Plato and the Greek classical thinking. Petrarca pointed out that Plato's teachings were in cohesion with Christianity, while Aristotle was not. He also attacked the influence of Averroes. Coluccio Salutati, who still knew Petrarca, was, like all humanists, an avid collector of handwritings and became, in 1375, the year of Boccaccio's death, the chancellor in Florence. Leonardo Bruni, who translated several of Plato's writings, was, from 1427 onward, the chancellor of this town. And Poggio Pragiolini was the chancellor from 1415 to 1422, who were the pupils of Salutati and represented the continuation of the Platonist anti-Aristotelian tradition. Pracciolini knew Cosimo de' Medici since the Council of Constance and also befriended Nicolaus there. Another group of people with whom Nicolaus got in contact with this tradition during his studies in Padua, where he became the close friend of Giuliano Gesarini, Ambrogio Traversari, and Enea Silvio Piccolomini, the later Pope Pius II, who were all in the same tradition of Dante, Petrarca, and Boccaccio. In Padua, Nicolaus also started his lifelong friendship with Paolo da Sposo Toscanelli, who wrote the famous letter to Martin de Maurice, where he argued that one could reach China and India on the sea route by going west, which later was used by Columbus and led to his discovery of the Americas. Through him, Nicolaus had close contact to the great artist Leon Battista Alberti and Filippo Brunelleschi. The translations of Bruni, Traversari, and others of Plato and Aristotle had already provoked profound debates about the good, the value of poetry, about the nature of the community, which represented the intellectual environment during Nicolaus' studies in Padua, which he clearly developed to a higher level in his Concordantia Catholica. But from 1437 onward, Nicolaus, mediated by his friend Cesarini, took over important functions in the papal church. And from this moment on, the history of Nicolaus, that of the Renaissance popes, and the cultural Renaissance became extremely closely intertwined. Already in 1437, Nicolaus traveled to Byzantium, where apart from his diplomatic mission to accompany and bring back the delegation of 700 representatives of the Orthodox Church, including the emperor and the patriarch, he used this occasion to bring successful in finding the documents proving that the formulation of the filioque, namely that the Spirit emanates equally from the Father and the Son, had already been part of the credo in the early councils. As we have published, this proof played a very important role for the unification of the Church in the councils of Ferrara and Florence. Nicolaus had the closest contact with the 83-year-old Georgios Gemistos Pleton, who accompanied the emperor as an advisor. Pleton at that point knew the totality of Plato, and naturally Proclus, and as a statesman in his own right, he intended a renaissance based on Plato for Greece. In 1439, he wrote a sharp critique of Aristotle while being in Florence. Aristotle would have misunderstood the Platonic ideas. He would deny God's creation of the world and the existence of providence, as well as of the immortality of the soul. He would undermine ethics, and his theory would be irreconcilable with Christianity. Pleason, Besarion, the Archbishop of Nicaea, who also wrote polemically against Aristotle, caused a total excitement about Plato in Ferrara. Can you please put on the first overhead slide? And especially the famous Dr. Ugo Benzi from Siena, who was teaching in Padua during Nicolaus' stay there, caused these debates. This is a painting which shows the arrival of these different delegations in Ferrara and Florence, where you can actually see that all the poets, statesmen, philosophers of the time gathered. The next one. Here you see the same picture in the palace of the Medicis portrayed on the wall. So you get actually a sense of the incredible architecture and beauty of the rooms. Cesarini, to whom Nicolaus had dedicated the Docta Ignorantia, was the host of many of these lectures about Plato, which excited one of his listeners, Cosimo de' Medici, in such a way that he decided to found a Platonic Academy in Florence and asked Plethon to translate the entire Plato. Nicolaus had also direct contact with Cosimo de' Medici and Petrus Leonius Perlioni from Spoleto, who was the personal doctor of Lorenzo de' Medici, collected several of Cusa's writings and distributed them further. Now switch to the... Just to illustrate the absolutely unbelievable intellectual and cultural environment in which Nicolaus worked. He had close contact with Tommaso Parentuccelli, later Pope Nicolaus V and the founder of the Vatican Library, Enea Silvio Piccolomini, later Pope Pius II, but also Niccolo Albergati. He saw the works of Alberti, Fra Angelico Donatello, first slide, Piero della Francesca, and Paolo Uccello. Here you see the famous resurrection of Piero della Francesca, who had finished in 1430, Uccello, who had finished in 1430 his frescoes in San Maria Novella, where Masaccio, please go to the next slides. Here you see the Trinity fresco by Masaccio, painted in a perspectivish form. Next. This is from Ghiberti, next. Piero della Francesca was in Florence from 1439 on. Ghiberti created the bronze door to the Battisterio in Florence and his Paradiso. Next, Brunelleschi in 1417 had created the first model of the cupola of the dome, which was completed in 1437, and already in 1429 he made new constructions of San Lorenzo and the Pozzi Chapel and San Spirito. Since the Italian and especially the Florentine Renaissance is a prime model to study how a civilization can overcome a dark age, it is useful to look how the different influences came together. Dante, Petrarca, and Boccaccio's influence created the foundation. From the beginning of the 15th century, several great artists and philosophers created a new humanist movement. But it was the councils of Ferrara and Florence, especially the contact with the Greek Platonic scholars, which gave this movement the decisive boost. This was the intellectual and cultural environment in which Nicolaus von Cus made a conceptual breakthrough. He himself writes that on the way back from Constantinople in 1437 to 1438, he would have experienced an enlightenment which allowed him to see all problems in a completely different light. This was his unique coincidence philosophy. Repeatedly, he stressed that he was teaching something which never had been thought before. He insisted that not one philosopher before him had recognized that method of thinking, embedded in the coincidentia oppositorum. Aristotle had pronounced the idea that contradicting statements could not be truthful at the same time. In a letter from the 14th September 1453, Nicolaus wrote that the non-allowance of contradicting statements would have been a common axiom of the entire philosophy. Aristotle only had said so in the most explicit form. All the philosophers would have failed, except in a couple of occasions, the great Dionysius. If one takes the totality of the attacks Nicolaus makes on Aristotle together, not much is left on him, of him. He dismantles him, the absolute master in the teachings of the scholastic movement in almost all universities, to somebody who has the wrong method, who cannot find anything while restlessly running back and forth, incapable of understanding Platonic ideas. In the Apologia Docta Ignorantia, Docta Ignorantiae, he defends a defense of the Docta Ignorantia against the Heidelberg professor Johannes Wenck, who had accused him of pantheism, heresy, and confusion, he writes, "Nowadays, the Aristotelian tendency is dominant, which finds the coincidence of opposites, which one has to acknowledge to find the ascent towards mythical theology to be a heresy." Now, you should note that the idea of mysticism during Cusa's time did not mean what it means today. It just meant a complete devotion to the truth. To those trained in this school, this approach seems to be totally nonsensical, the Aristotelians. They refuse it as something completely opposite to their intentions. Therefore, it would be close to a miracle, as well as it would be a complete transformation of the school, if they would abandon Aristotle and reach a higher level. Nicholaus then quotes Hieronymus, quoting Philo, by basically making the point that logic, the Aristotelian thinking, is not better than the understanding, the ratio of the animal, because all understanding beings, humans and animals, would be able to draw conclusions. The methodological approach, he writes, is necessarily, meaning the Aristotelian level of understanding, is necessarily limited between the starting point and the final point. And these opposing opposites we call contradictions. Therefore, for the methodological proceeding thinking, the goals are opposites and separates. Therefore, on the level of understanding, the extremes are separated, like the notion of the circle, which says that the center cannot coincide with the circumference, because the distance from the center point to the circumference is always the same. But on the level of the reasonable mind, who sees that within unity, the number, within the point, the line, and in the center, the circle is folded in, the convergence of unity and multiplicity, point and line, center and circumference, are reached in the vision of the mind without methodological back and forth. That you could see in the book De Conjecturis, where I showed that God is even above the coincidence of the contradictory opposites, because according to Dionysius, he is the opposite of opposites. It is not very respectful that Nicholaus talks here about the methodological back and forth of the Aristotelians. And what does he mean by their intentions? Then Nicholaus continues, "After these words, the master reminded me to note that the learned ignorance, like a high tower, brings everybody to the level of vision. Because he who is standing up there has an overview about everything, which the one which is moving over the field, looking for the different traces he is searching for. But he also sees how far the one searching is getting closer or further away from what he's looking for. In this way, the learned ignorance, which belongs to the domain of the reasonable mind, judges about the methodological approach of the thought process of the understanding. The metaphor of the tower, in which reason is self-conscious about itself, the searcher and the searched, is one pedagogical device to help the mind to think in an elevated way from above. Another one is in his writings De Berillo, the idea of the coincidence teaching as a spectacle, through which one can see that which was previously invisible. The coincidence thinking is not what is seen, it is the method of thinking. In De Berillo, Nicholaus describes the sensuous world as a book written for us, even created for, in such a way that we can understand it from the way our cognition works. Nicholaus develops here truly a subjective cognition approach. Other thinkers before Nicholaus had conceived the idea of a unity before all contradictory statements. What makes the coincidence thinking and the metaphor of the barrel as a spectacle different is to show how contradicting substantial causes, Wesensgründe, coexist in a principled connectedness before they separate into their differentiation. If we have the barrel, we see the opposites in principio convexio before they exist in their duality. In the rectangular, the minimum of the acute angle and the minimum of the obtuse angle coincide. Before they separate into their contradictoriness, they are together in the rectangular. As we will see, these are no academic exercises, but Nicholas develops here a method of thinking which has the most fundamental significance for the solution of political and religious problems. And because Aristotle does not have a barrel, he cannot think in an efficient way. In the barrel, he escalates the attacks on Aristotle, even though he would have talked about a third principle of natural occurrences, Aristotle that is, namely the steresis, the privatio, or the beraubung, but this would be only an empty construct. It would not explain anything, but only the absence of something. After he had introduced this worthless explanation, Nicholas says, he got stuck in his scientific research, and Aristotle concluded that Aristotle had therefore no more significance for the contemporary scientific studies, which at that point was an absolute, truly revolutionary statement. But there is also a very specific evolutionary conception that Nicholas' coincidence thinking has for the evolution of the universe, which emphasizes its unity. But in a radical difference to the absolute unity and biggestness, maximitas, which is God, the unitas universi is a constructed multitude, unitas contracta, the incarnation of the unified multitude, maximum contractum. In this universe exists a hierarchical order of higher and lower species, which each other develop into each other for a multiple individual differentiation, but which are nevertheless separated each by a species gap. Nicholas says that no animal by itself can become reasonable. But if some animal would be educatable in such a way, capax, that the animal would develop inside in the inside of man and would prove this through his action, it would no longer be just an animal. Nicholas says that no individual of any kind, as long as it is not more than an individual of its kind, has actualized its maximum perfection capacity. For man, this means that he will be snatched up and mixed up with the spiritual nature. Analog, the inorganic is in relation to the plant and the vegetative to the animal life. The potentiality of the lower only accomplishes its perfect fulfillment through its introduction into a higher principle of being. But the fascinating thing is that what the late Professor Haupst calls the biogenetic law of evolution, the maximation principle of Cusa, does not work from below upwards. Evolution is not understood as starting with the most primitive form to eventually become more differentiated, which the mechanistic theory of evolution today suggests, but it occurs from above. In Demente, Nicholas develops that God's knowledge only descends downward into the nature of the mind. Further down in the scale of things, it only descends through the mind. Mens, the mind, even this is a very weightful concept of Nicholas, is the image of God, but at the same time, the original image of all successive creatures. This puts man in an extraordinary position in the universe. The world-creating mind, God, has only one avenue to the world, the human mind. It is only a theory, this is not only a theory of cognition, This is a theory of world formation, of genesis, in which the mind has an irreplaceable mediation role. This is exactly the same idea when Lin says that the universe obeys the cognitive powers of the mind. Professor Herbst reads Cusa even in this way, that for Nicholaus, the universe finds its fulfillment of meaning only in the designation of man. In that sense, for the universe, man is irreplaceable. The universe needs man to have a meaning. Without man, the universe would only be a torso. If the universe is not just to end somehow, its sense designation and perfection can only be in the divine creative activity of the human mind. In Demente, Nicholaus von Kues writes that the number is a coincidence of unity and multiplicity. Here we see that he does not restrict the coincidence thinking to theological questions. These numbers are constitutive because the eternal mind has created the world in a number-like way, like the composer composes. It is mind as mind which creates the number and everything else. The world is the music of the eternal mind which causes the proportions and therefore the beauty of the world, worldly things. We recognize here an idea which we find again in Kepler. In Demente, Cusa describes the infinite perfectibility of the mind, which creates motions bringing order into the world, and in this way finds out its own laws of cognition. As I said, this method of thinking from the above, from the coincidentia oppositorum, is a universal methodological concept applicable to all aspects of life. The most far-reaching discussion of this idea next we find in the Division. Now, this is the hospital created by Brunelleschi, which is very similar. It's one of the first public common good examples in the form of a hospital, which is exactly what Nicholaus did in Bernkastel Kues, and which exists also in Mons in France. Hospitals were an extremely important part of this idea of the emerging of the common good. Next. Yeah, this is a self-portrait of Dürer, and the great art historian Maria Schmitz has come to the conclusion that this is probably inspired by De Visione Dei by Nicholaus, where he uses the an icon which is painted in such a way that wherever the onlooker goes around in a circle, he always thinks that the eyes of the person of God, of Christ, are directed towards him. And this is a very beautiful expression of this. This book, De Visione Dei, Nicholaus wrote for the monks of Tegernsee, who were his close friends. And it's probably the most intimate of all of Cusa's writings. Plato had made the argument that in order to be truly free and philosophize, you have to be among friends. Because if you are together with people who are not your friends, you cannot speak freely. You have self-protection and you guard yourself, and that blocks the ability of the mind to really come to the truth. So Nicholaus wrote this book, De Visione Dei, for his friends, the monks, and they clearly represent his innermost thoughts. This book, just because it was so intimate and loving, already in the 15th century, was one of the most read of his writings. It reminds me very much of the spiritual exercises of the Pope, described by the Vietnamese bishop Phan Nguyen Di. And it is about the question of how to train the mind to think from the level of the highest truth. In this case, he uses the notion that God, the opposite of opposites, is behind the wall of the coincidentia oppositorum, that you have to elevate your mind to that divine level to be able to tackle all problems from the highest level going below. Complementary to De Visione Dei one must see another one of his books written in the same year, namely 1453. And here you can see that the coincidence thinking is not some esoteric far away of mystical in the modern way, a way of dreaming, but has the most dramatic political implications. In 1453, Sultan Mohammed II, who had the title the Conqueror, had on the 29th of May in 53 his most spectacular success, the takeover of Constantinople. The West saw this fall of Constantinople as a total threat. Even the humanist Aeneas Silvio wrote to Pope Nicholas V that his hand would be trembling while he was writing these words. And for pain he could not speak. He said, "What a misery for Christendom. The fountain of the muses would have dried out. This would be the second death of Homer and Plato." The reaction to these reports, what happened in Constantinople, were those of total terror. First of all, I will now just use a quote from the Cusa scholar Erich Meuthen, how he reports how the descriptions of the fall of Constantinople were received in the West. First of all, horror about the carnage. The West's image of the Turk was painted as a shrill mixture of bloodthirst, bestial cruelty, and perversion. The reports from Constantinople correspond to what was considered to be certain anyway. Yes, it could be accurated. Blood was flooding the ground as if it had rained, like water in the streets. Blood was flowing. Children would have been killed before the eyes of their parents. Noblemen slaughtered like animals. Priests mutilated. Monks tortured to death. Holy virgins raped. Mothers and daughters dishonored. It is reported that Mahmed, the conqueror, forced the emperor's daughter in his bed in the night of his victory. He wanted to convert her to his belief. She stands firm. Now he drags her to the Hagia Sophia, towards the statue of the Madonna, which is used as a chopping block for executions. He shows her how Christians are being beheaded here, rips off her clothes, and orders the girl to be beheaded on top of the Madonna and sends her head to the Emperor Constantine. Desecration of man and God in one. Churches are vandalized, altars profaned, reliquies dispersed in all the winds. The holy of the holy desecrated, and so on and so on. Now, this happened in the 15th century, but it is happening today in the Middle East and many other places in Africa and the Balkans. And just now, just to help me to celebrate the birthday of Nicholas, the Pope went on this truly historic mission to the Middle East. And 2 days ago, he made a statement and he said, "Look, I ask for forgiveness for the crimes and the cruelties committed by the Crusaders in the 13th century," which I think is a truly noble gesture that he, you know, almost on a personal mission to counter what is being done by Bush and Sharon, to bring peace to the Middle East, to make an effort to overcome this terrible danger of war of which the Pope is absolutely aware. Then today he's going to a mosque, which is the grave of Johannes, and it's the first time that a Pope goes to a mosque. So, you know, this is not theoretical academic stuff from many centuries away. This has the highest political significance if we want to find peace. Now, modern historians refute these horror stories and say that Mohammed II would not have intended to destroy the city. On the contrary, that he would have reconstructed public buildings and that he would have brought groups of Muslims, Christians, and Jews in the city for resettlement, and that he would have sponsored the arts and the sciences. That may be historically true. I only mentioned this quote to show you that these horror stories was what the West had as an image of what had happened. All the more amazing it is to see the elevated, lofty view of Nicholas, which he represents in his Departio Fidei about the peace in belief, in faith, written under the impression of the terrible reports I just mentioned above. Nicholas begins the Departio Fidei with the following words. The tidings of the cruelties which have been committed in Constantinople by the Turk king recently have become known and have filled a man who once has been in these areas, and he's obviously talking about himself and his trip in 1433, with so much ardor for God that with many a sigh asked the Creator that he in his goodness might mitigate the prosecutions which was raging because of the religious practices more than ever. There, it occurred, after several days, probably because of his daily continued contemplation, that a vision was granted to the enraptured man, which told him that it were possible through the experience of a few wise men who are familiar with the different habits in the religions of the world to find a single and happy unity by which an eternal peace of the religions could be formed in a fitting and true way. Cusa then has representatives of 17 religions and countries in a dialogue with the divine Verbum asking for help, because they say, because of you, whom alone they are looking for in what they all seem to be adoring, this quarrel rages. So these representatives of 17 religions and countries go to God and say, look, we are only killing each other because of you, because we all think that we do your work. Please help us to overcome this terrible contradiction. Interestingly, Nicholas presents in the beginning of the dialogue an illusionless view about the oligarchical power structures of his time. One should consider, he says, that most human beings would be forced to spend their lives in misery and big strains. They, on top of this, would live in slavish dependency from their rulers. Therefore, almost none of them has the leisure to make use of their freedom of will and arrive at a cognition about themselves. Worries about the physical condition and services they had to perform would distract them too much. Therefore, they did not get to it to search for the hidden God. But if a union of wise men coming from all the different religions would come together, it would be easy to find a solution. The approach Nicholas then develops really reflects the vision from above. He says that religious war is due to some up to now not discovered flaws in the self-understanding of the religions. One mistake would be not to differentiate between the prophet and God himself. And secondly, they would mix up traditions to which they are used to with the truth. So basically, the difference would only exist in rites and not in the essence. Now, this is a truly mind-boggling approach, because who could possibly argue that the prophets would be on the same level of God? So if you say that the differences are only because of the different circumstances of the different prophets, but they are not identical with God, and that, you know, the different traditions are not the same thing like the truth, it is obviously easy to find a solution. Then the oldest of the participating philosopher, a Greek, asks, but how should we bring the manifold of religions together in one unity? Since our people have defended their religions with blood, they hardly are willing to accept a new unified religion. But the divine Verbum answers, you should not introduce a new religion, but you should first comprehend yourselves and then show it to the peoples that the true religion is presupposed before all other religions. The unity is before the separation occurs. Since divine Verbum is talking to the wise men as philosophers, they can all agree that there is only one wisdom. And he does not talk to them as representatives of different religions, and therefore he can reach them on the level of reason on a different level. The peace-bringing new unity of religion is not, and Nicholas is very emphatic on that, a synthetic new belief, but what reason tells all of them who became conscious of its premises. So the Greek philosopher reacts excitedly about the spiritual rationalis, which is capable of capax artitium mirabilium, the participating in the wonder, the ability of the mind to participate in the most beautiful creations of art. And what follows is a hymn on the perfectibility of the human spirit. If this spirit is oriented to wisdom, then he gets closer and closer to it. We never reach the absolute wisdom, but we approximate it more and more. It tastes as well like a sweetness, more and more like eternal nourishment. So the unity is guaranteed when the orientation of the mind towards wisdom and truth is recognized as primary and basic. Then the participation mediates between the one and the many. Sometimes it is only the experience of great catastrophe, as it was the perception of the fall of Constantinople in the West, and as it is the threatening perspective of a generalized war in the Middle East today, which shocks people into a serious thinking of an alternative. If there is then an appeal to that alternative, and wise men and women take this initiative, the catastrophe may be avoided. In the Docta Ignorantia, he speaks of the spiritus universorum, the spirit of universality, which is efficient in every aspect of creation. Religions or nations or people are elements of differentiation, but the totality, the universe, as the most perfect order of according to its nature, is presupposed to everything, so that everything can be in everything. This is Cusa's famous formulation, quod libet in quo libet. Concerning the political order, this means that the multitude of peoples can be integrated without a violation of their specific identity, because the totality of the order is already given before. Further insight into the relation between the one and the many in Cusa's notion is that every human being is a microcosm. Dr. Alim talked yesterday about the DC general as a microcosm, which is absolutely true, which means that he has not just man being a microcosm, not just has a place in the universe, the macrocosm, but he contains the entire cosmos in himself in a complicated way. Every person, therefore, is the whole universe in the small. Therefore, any peace order cannot be based on some secondary consideration, but it can only exist if each microcosm has the chance to develop its fullest potential, which it can only do if all microcosms develop in a maximum way. This has tremendous implications for the relations among human beings, among nations, and among people. A peace order of sovereign nations can only exist if each one is allowed to develop in the best possible way, which means that the common good is taken care of in the optimal way so that all of its citizens can prosper and their talents flourish. Only if each microcosm understands that it is in the self-best interest that all the other microcosms develop in the best way. Only if each nation and if each people desire the best development of all others, concordance can exist in the macrocosm and in the world as a whole. This is why peace negotiations, which focus only on the matters of conflict on the level of understanding, so-called political solutions, or what Cusa would call the Aristotelian way of running back and forth, one could say he's almost talking about an Aristotelian shuttle diplomacy, do not work. One has to start with the coincidence thinking, the agreement of the minds concerning the final goal of mankind as a whole, which is self-perfection, ennoblement, the increase in the general population potential as a condition for the continued existence of generations to come, and naturally the construction of the Eurasian land bridge today as the basis and cornerstone for a global reconstruction, being an expression of such a final goal of mankind as a whole. These philosophical questions must be there in the beginning as a precondition for a functioning peace of the world. And this is why the ideas of Nicholas are the most modern ideas I can possibly think of previous thinkers. What is needed for today to heal the wounds of all the tortured people in Africa, in the Balkans, in the Middle East, in other areas in the world, is that focus on the spiritus universorum, but also the limitless cultural optimism as expressed, for example, in Nicolaus' sermon for the Epiphany Day, which he held 1454 in Brixen, and which has been called correctly a hymn on civilization, which praises the free and mechanical arts and the sciences as the great gift to mankind, which must be shared by all so that the development of none is unnecessarily delayed. At the end of the experiment of the layman with the scale, he even says every new discovery must be given in an international pool where every people should have access so that nobody's development is unnecessarily delayed. Nicholas von Cusa was convinced that this was the only human way of thinking, and I fully agree with him. In 1459, he wrote that the human soul is substantially superior to all otherness. She can eliminate all otherness because she has the non-other image of everything. If the soul thinks in this way, she is the intertemporal tempus, he says, in the timeless time. It is what Lynn calls the simultaneity of eternity. Today, the idea of a community of sovereign nations based on the common good for all and based on the international law of peoples has become a life and death issue for the entire human civilization. Can we not, for our own sake, and as the nicest birthday present we could give to Nicholas of Cusa for his 600th birthday, develop the same power of intellect, the same existential commitment and passion to great ideas? If I look around in this room, I see representatives from all corners of the world. Let's be joyful about the multitude of cultural differentiation and beauty, because we are one before we are many.